Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. So guys, have you heard that you can do RTGS and NEFT from your PhonePe, Paytm or Google Pay accounts as well? If you haven't heard this thing, then I am going to tell you all about it. Okay, the next thing we are going to discuss is about the e-Rupee that has been launched by the Prime Minister of India. So what is this e-Rupee? Is the central bank digital currency which the RBI was talking about has been implemented in India. Have we already brought the central bank digital currency in India? So is e-Rupee, is that digital currency? So these are some of the questions, and I would say these are some of the interesting topics that we are going to discuss in this video only. So do listen to me very carefully till the end of this video, because not only these two questions, but apart from these two news, I am going to tell you a lot of interesting news as well. So myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs, let's begin today's video. But before that, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, guys, then do subscribe, and you can also join this Telegram group. Okay, so let's begin with the first question. Which platform has been launched by Prime Minister Narendra Modi to provide benefit of schemes and initiatives to the people via QR code or SMS link? E-Rupee, E-Mudra, E-Bhuktan, E-Pay, E-Dhan. So it is very obvious, it is E-Rupee, because I have told you in the beginning of this video itself that we are going to discuss about E-Rupee. Now, what is this E-Rupee? First of all, it is not the central bank digital currency. Okay, so remove that thing from your mind. That was just to arouse your curiosity about this E-Rupee. So this is not the digital currency. This is not the central bank digital currency. If you want to know what the central bank digital currency is and how is it implemented and what are the mechanisms related to this, then we already have covered this in a video on our channel, and that video is by Tanvi ma'am. So if you want to know the classics and the basics of the central bank digital currency, then you can watch that video. Coming back to this e-Rupee, this is basically payment without cash. You can understand it in this way. Payment to mil raha hai, but there is no cash. So here, the government has launched this e-Rupee in order to provide direct benefit transfer to the beneficiaries, but not in the form of cash, in the form of QR code or SMS string-based e-voucher. Basically, this SMS string-based e-voucher means that you will get the SMS link, and through that link, by using that link, you can avail the benefit. Now, why did the government do this? Because it was observed by the government that the people are not spending money at the cause for which they were given the money. For example, if you take the example of Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. Here, the government provides money to the farmers so that they can purchase inputs. But it was seen that some of the farmers were not purchasing the inputs. Instead, they were using that money for their alcohol or for any other private purpose, whatever it is. But the targeted cause for which the money is given under the scheme is not being fulfilled. In order to remove that barrier, this DBT, this e-Rupee has been launched, which will provide direct benefit transfer via QR code. Now, how is it going to work? It is going to work in a way. For example, if I am the farmer under this Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana, I will get the QR code in my mobile, in my register mobile. Then I will be able to go to the input shop, to the outlet which is selling the fertilizer. For example, we are talking about the fertilizer. So I will go to the shop which is selling the fertilizer. Basically, that shopkeeper will get paid by the government, but I can use that QR code to get fertilizer at the amount which is specified in the QR code, because this is basically a prepaid instrument. It is already paid, so I can make purchase only to the amount which is already paid, only to the amount which is allocated under this scheme to individual beneficiary. So this way, first thing that is resolved through this e-Rupee is that the payment got to the right person. I am the right beneficiary under this Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. I got the payment. Secondly, I spent the money on the cause for which I got the money. Okay, I did not spend it on my cosmetics. I spent it for the input, for cultivation. So that is the purpose for launching this e-rupee. Right person and right cause. To give the money to the right person and to the right cause. So this is also going to reduce corruption. This is going to eliminate the intermediaries in between. And here the amount will be directly transferred, or we can say the benefit will be directly transferred to the beneficiaries. And the beneficiaries will be able to spend it on the right cause. So that is how this e-rupee is going to work. Okay, so that was all about this e-rupee's functioning. Now let us understand some facts related to this e-rupee, like how many banks are there that have already been put on this, that have already been onboarded on this platform, or which company is providing the technological support to the banks for implementing this platform, and things like that. First of all, here you will get the meaning. It is a QR code or SMS string based e-voucher. E-voucher, you will not get cash in the form of the real cash in your hand. Also, you will not get the benefit in your bank accounts. But remember that it is just launched. Work on it. Basically, the transfer through this e-rupee has not been made because it was launched on August 2nd only. So that is something you need to know. Now, this is about the functioning of e-rupee that I have already told you. Okay, so this e-rupee is not only restricted to the government organizations, corporates or charity organizations can also use this e-rupee platform in order to provide benefit to their employees. For the corporates, it is employees, or for the charity organizations, to the targeted population. So this is how this e-rupee is going to benefit a lot of people. So I'm just skipping reading all this. You can read it on your own and take a screenshot of it as well if you want. So developers, who has developed this great platform? It has been developed by National Payment Corporation of India. And remember that the outlets from where the beneficiaries can get the input, or the beneficiaries can avail the benefit, that platform or the owner of that platform will get paid by the government only. So he is not going to give it for free. The next thing is that National Payment Corporation of India has developed this in collaboration with Department of Financial Services, Health Ministry and National Health Authority. So here health related schemes are also there, wherein you will get amount, you will get cash from the government, like Ayushman Bharat scheme. Waise toh wahan cashless treatment hota hai. But still, there are certain schemes wherein you will get amount from the government so that you can spend it on your medical treatment. But some people spend it on their sedentary habits. So in order to avoid that, all these organizations collaborated to launch e-rupee. Infrasoft Tech is the organization that is providing e-rupee technology stack to the banks by helping them in implementing the technology. So basically, this is helping the banks to implement this technology. Who are the issuing banks? So it is working with two banks right now out of the 11 live banks as per the NPCI. Basically, 11 banks are onboarded on this e-rupee platform. But out of those 11 banks, only two banks are currently operational or in the mode of operating this e-rupee. So these two banks are Punjab National Bank and Bank of Baroda. Next is popularity of UPI. So this is just an additional point. In July, record UPI transactions were recorded. 300 crore UPI transactions were recorded in the month of July only. And the total amount was 6 lakh crore rupees. So this is indicating not only the increasing popularity of UPI, but also the ubiquity of UPI. That means it is not only restricted to the younger population. It is not only restricted to the urban population. It is also going to the rural populations, to the aged populations as well. So if the UPI is so ubiquitous and so popular, so why not we use it for transferring the direct benefit transfer to the people? So that was something that they might have thought, and they created this e-rupee platform. Now I hope that you have understood it well. So I'm moving on to the second question. But if you have any query, you can always ask me in the comment section or on the Telegram group. Moving on to the next question. How much amount has been allocated by the Union Budget of 2021 for setting up the National Research Foundation? So, this National Research Foundation was announced in 2019's budget. In 2021 budget, the amount of rupees 50,000 crores was allocated for setting up this National Research Foundation. Right now it is in the news because it was discussed in the Rajya Sabha. Monsoon session of parliament is ongoing, and during that session only the work related to this National Research Foundation was discussed. And what is the work that has been done towards this foundation? Only the allocation of the money, because you need to understand this thing that in February only amount was allocated, so it will take time to set up this organization. Now, why are we setting up this organization? Because we need to boost up our research and development ecosystem in India if we want to move ahead, because digital revolution is knocking at our doors. And if we do not do research and development in the automation and IT field, then we will lag behind among the other countries. Okay, so in order to boost the research and development ecosystem in India, this research foundation is going to be set up by the government. And remember that this is the first time that the National Research Foundation is being set up in India, which makes it all the more important. Okay, so that was all. So what are the things that you need to know? The amount only. So that is the sum, that is the thing wherein you will need to put your effort. Because you have to remember 50,000 crores. Apart from this, all the things are understanding based. If you have understood it once, then you know, won't need to put in extra effort to memorize it. Okay, so that was all about this question. Moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements is not correct about the Secured Logistics Document Exchange platform? So recently central government has launched this Secured Logistics Document Exchange platform as well as a calculator for greenhouse gas emissions from transportation, from transports. Vehicles. Now, what is the purpose of this and what is this that we are going to discuss? But let's first discuss the options and the answer of this question. So, which statement is not correct about this logistics exchange platform, logistics document exchange platform? Option A says that the digital initiative is now set to improve logistics efficiency, reduce logistics cost, and promote multimodality and sustainability in a big way. Option B, the platform will replace the present manual process of generation, exchange, and compliance of logistics documents with a digitized, secure, and seamless document exchange system. The platform can be used via Aadhaar and blockchain-based security protocols for data security and authentication. The platform is integrated with My Government platform. None of the above. So which one is the incorrect statement? The incorrect statement is option D. This platform is not yet integrated with the My Government platform. Apart from this, all these statements are correct. So if you were to put it in one line, the purpose behind launching this secured logistics document exchange platform, then I would like to say that this platform has been launched in order to ease out the process of logistic document sharing and generating. So all the document generating process, the sharing of document, all these kinds of work will be done online through this platform. Now, why do we need to create such kind of a platform? The reason behind this is to reduce the logistic cost, because at present India incurs, do pay attention to the figures that I am going to tell you because these are very important. India incurs up to 14% of basically the logistic cost that India incurs is worth 14% of India's GDP. So this is the logistic cost that we incur. The global average is 8%. And we are way behind this global target, okay, global average. So the Indian government has set a target to reduce this logistic cost to 10%. By 2022, from 14% of GDP at present. And in order to achieve this target, this platform has been launched, because this also requires a lot of expenditure and also this requires a lot of carbon footprint. So it increases the carbon footprint because there is a lot of use of paper, and if everything is on online platform, then it is going to be eco-friendly as well. So these are the targets. 14% is the present cost logistics, 8% is the global global average, and 10% is our target. Apart from this, you also need to know that India is implementing the Freight Smart Cities mission. And the purpose of these Freight Smart Cities was also to reduce the last mile logistic cost. Okay, that accounts for 50% of the total logistic cost. Last mile is the logistic cost that is incurred for providing, for supplying or delivering the product to the final consumer. So the logistic cost that is incurred during that stage is the last mile logistic cost. So I have taught you this Freight Smart Cities initiative in detail in my Morning Tales video only. So if you want to see that, you can go to the Morning Tales playlist and watch it from there. Okay. So I told you about the calculator that was launched for GHG, greenhouse gas emissions. So this is basically, this calculator is going to provide information to the transporters or to the logistics owners or the people, stakeholders involved in logistics, so that they can assess that which mode of vehicle is responsible for higher GHG emissions, and from taking input from this calculator, they can reduce their GHG emissions. So they basically, this is going to provide information about the greenhouse gas emissions from different modes of transportation, and also compare the GHG emissions between different modes of transportation. So that is the purpose of launching this calculator. So that was all about this question. How many state-owned general insurance companies are present in India? 7, 10, 4, 5, 2. So the right answer is 4. First one is National Insurance Company. National Insurance Company, New India Assurance Insurance Company, and Oriental Insurance Company, United India Insurance Company. So these are the four public sector general insurance companies that are present in India. Now in Union Budget of this year, it was announced by Finance Minister that two public sector banks and one general insurance company in the public sector will be privatized. Now, the names of the public sector banks as well as this insurance company which will be privatized has not been revealed by the minister till now. It is just the information that one of these insurance companies will be privatized. Okay, so that is why it was in the news. Basically, in the Rajya Sabha only, it was announced that the work on this is being done. Guys, can you tell me that which act, under which act basically, under which act the privatization of this insurance company will take place? That is something that you need to tell me in the comment section below. How much minimum net worth is required by non-bank entities to access to get access to RBI's centralized payment systems? 30 crores, 25, 10 crores, 40 crores, 50 crores. The right answer is 25 crores. Now, this centralized payment system is RTGS and NEFT. So basically, RBI has allowed the non-bank entities, like the payment service providers, like we have Airtel Payment Service, Airtel Payments, and we have Paytm, PhonePe. All these payment service providers will now be able to process RTGS as well as NEFT transactions because they have got the access to this centralized payment payment systems of RBI. Now, under this centralized payment system, RBI owns and operates these two systems only. So before moving ahead towards the benefits and the eligibility criteria for the non-bank entities, I would like to discuss some things about the RTGS and NEFT first. So guys, first of all, the maximum limit is 10 lakhs. That I hope that you all know. But what are the minimum limits? This is your question that you have to tell me in the comment section below. Minimum limit of fund transfer in RTGS as well as in NEFT. Now, you should know that in December 2019 or from December 2019 onwards, this RTGS, this NEFT is available 24/7 for the whole year. RTGS was made available in December 2020. So 24/7. For the whole year. So RTGS and NEFT is now available at all the times in India. So these were the facts related to these two facilities, real-time gross settlement and national electronic fund transfer. Okay? Minimum limits. Do not forget to tell me the minimum limits of both these transactions. How much amount do we need in order to transfer fund through NEFT or RTGS? Now let's discuss what are the benefits. Why do we do such a thing? Why did RBI do this thing? What are the benefits to the non-bank entities as well as to the economy? Okay, so here the benefits are listed. For the non-bank entities, it will be a reduction in cost of payments as well as bank pay dependence kam ho jayegi because now they are going to process the RTGS and NEFT themselves. Then completing payment complete karne mein time bhi bahut kam lagega because we have already seen this thing that I use Paytm. So Paytm is quite efficient when it comes to UPI transactions or other kinds of transactions in comparison to any other mobile banking that we can use. Mobile apps of the banks. That is something I wanted to tell. Eliminating the uncertainty in the finality of the payments because here again the entire work will be in the hands of the payment service provider. Avoiding the risk of failure or delay in the execution of funds transfer. So these are the benefits. Now what are the benefits for economy? That is of most importance. It will lower the overall risk in the payment ecosystem, increase the efficiency, innovation will be there if we put it in the hands of private players, improved standards of data security will also be there and better risk management. So these are the benefits to the economy or to the overall payment ecosystem of India. Now let us have a look at the eligibility criteria. So a minimum net worth of rupees 25 crore is required from the side of payment service providers. Okay, they need to have adequate technology, cyber security infrastructure, data localization norms se bhi unko compliance comply karna chahiye. Foreign entities would need India incorporated subsidiaries in order to run this operation. Entities incorporated outside India shall empower their local offices to carry out all operations in respect of CPS, jo bhi RTGS NEFT karna hai, local office karega, but the accountability will be held with the foreign parent. institution which has taken the authorization as payment service provider. Okay. The next point is that the access to these non-bank entities will be given in a phased manner, and in the first phase, it has been decided that prepaid payment instruments, card networks, and white label operators will be allowed access. So that was all about the centralized payment system. It was very interesting, right? Because from now onwards, then whenever this comes into implementation, we will be able to transfer funds within a snap of our fingers. So that is a great news for all of us, right? But guys, whenever you are doing any kind of financial payment online, do pay attention, keep all the safety measures before making fund transfers online, because frauds have been increased in the COVID time period. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. Which bank's stake has been bought by the International Finance Corporation under the greening equity approach? So first of all, this IFC is the investment arm of World Bank. It basically invests in equity and debt of other institutions, lending institutions, and from there it earns money for World Bank. So Bank of India, Federal Bank, Indian Bank, Union Bank of India, Canara Bank, out of which Federal Bank is the right answer. Now this greening equity approach is important. वैसे तो ज़्यादा कुछ नहीं है, it's very easy if you understand it, and if you try to learn it by rote, then it will become difficult for you. So try to understand it, because it is not at all difficult. The first thing, let me tell you, is that it was launched in 2018 at the World Bank and IMF annual meeting. Not at all important, but year is important, 2018. The next thing, equity. So under this greening equity approach, basically this IFC invests in the equity of lending institutions. And by investing in the lending institutions, it constantly encourages those lending institutions to further finance and lend the money to the clean environment project, to the clean energy projects and climate related projects. That is the whole purpose, greening equity, making the equity green or more friendly to the environment, climate friendly. So that is the whole purpose. First, IFC will invest in certain bank or in certain lending institution, then it will encourage that lending institution to further lend to the climate related projects. That is all related regarding this greening equity approach. So that was all for today. I hope that you have learned something. Thank you so much for watching the video. Do not forget to watch, to come at our channel at 10 a.m. for March Spotlight. Thank you so much.